بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله أما بعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته brothers and sisters, how you guys doing? And Alhamdulillah, we have finally made it to one of the greatest moments in the entire history. In fact, Ibn al-Qayyim, one of the famous scholars of Islam, he says that Fath Mecca, or the conquest of Mecca, the thing that we're going to talk about today, is the single greatest moment in the entire seerah, because the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Sahaba finally are able to return to their home, return to the Kaaba, which is something very sacred and holy in the Islamic tradition, and they are finally able to restore monotheism and true worship for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone in this blessed sacred city. So this is one of the greatest, in fact, even if we want to, as Ibn al-Qayyim says, the greatest moment in the entire history. Alhamdulillah. When we go from the beginning episodes of Seerah, me and you recall, where the Muslims were being persecuted and tortured and kicked out of their home, to finally now where all power and might is in the hands of the Muslims once and for all. Now, that being said, being the greatest moment in the entire history, of course the narrations and the reports and the stories that occurred in this conquest in Fath Mecca are unimaginable. They're in the amount. So it is impossible for me and you in one episode, two episodes, three episodes, and whatever amount of episodes to talk about Fath Mecca and extract all the lessons and rulings and the things that happened in this, you know, this blessed event. So me and you, as we did throughout the entire seerah, we're going to focus on the story of the Fath Mecca and derive some lessons from them without taking too long and making it simplified and as understandable as possible while holding on to authenticity. Now, Fath Mecca, before we even talk about the conquest of Mecca and how great an event it was and what happened in it, we have to put ourselves in the context of how did the Fath Mecca happen in the first place? How did the conquest of Mecca happen in the first place? Okay, in order for us to understand the concept, we have to go back to the Treaty of Hudaybiyah. And me and you discussed the clauses of the Treaty of Hudaybiyah. And if you recall, one of the clauses in the Treaty of Hudaybiyah was that the Muslims and the Quraysh can form allegiances and can form treaties with whoever they want. Now, of the many people that the Muslims and the Quraysh formed treaties with, we have two tribes in specific that me and you want to focus on. One of them is Banu Bakr, and the other one is the tribe of Khuza'a. Banu Bakr, they formed an allegiance, a treaty with Quraysh, and you had the Khuza'a who formed an allegiance and a treaty with the Prophet Muhammad. In fact, most of the Khuza'a, they even accepted Islam. Now, just a little fun fact, if you guys recall so long ago, subhanAllah, if you can understand like the messages and the hidden themes, who was the first person to bring an idol into Mecca? It was Amr, if you guys recall, and he was the chief or the head of the tribe of Khuza'a. And subhanAllah, look how the Khuza'a started the idolatry and everything that happened in Mecca, and subhanAllah, from the Prophet Muhammad, he is going to end idolatry, as we're clearly going to see in the end of this episode. Anyways, just a little fun fact. Now we have these two tribes, Banu Bakr, Khuza'a. Khuza'a is with the Muslims and Banu Bakr is with the Quraysh. Now, as we discussed many times in the past, and the concept of or the definition of what a treaty means, it clearly shows that when I enter a treaty with someone, I basically become their ally. Meaning if I attack someone, that my ally is with me and he's going to fight with me. And if someone attacks me or my ally, it's as if he has attacked both of us because we are both a team. And also it's true is that if I attack some person, that also means that I attacked someone else because they are an ally. So we understand the concept is that the concept of me forming a treaty with someone is that we become one, is that we become allies, and anything that I do or you do in terms of military is one. Anyways, so we have Banu Bakr. And Banu Bakr in the eighth, in the month of Sha'ban, in the eighth year of the Hijrah, they choose to go and disregard the treaty completely. And they go with the assistance and the help and the aid of Quraysh to go attack the Khuza'a tribe at night in a place called Al-Watir. They clearly go against the contract. And clearly the Quraysh, not only because they are an ally of Banu Bakr, they are also hold responsibility, but they also helped and aided them with men and with weapons. That's clear. And the reason why Banu Bakr and Quraysh, they wanted to go attack Khuza'ah, because some people may say, why they just woke up out of nowhere and just said they wanted to attack and they broke the treaty. Rather, we have to go back to some concepts that we explained many times of pre-Islamic or pre before the Prophet Muhammad was a prophet, the conditions and the customs of the Arab. We said that the Arab, they had many tribal feuds, many tribal beefs, if you want. So one of these feuds, one of these two groups of people that used to constantly fight was Khuza'ah and Banu Bakr. However, after this treaty formed, and even during the time of the prophethood, nothing really sparked between them. And you can say the last feud between the two, Khuza'ah was the victor. So it was Banu Bakr who was next in terms of getting revenge on Khuza'ah. However, that opportunity never came to them except for right now. However, now is a different situation. The Prophet peace be upon him clearly said in many speeches and in many treaties with other people that now pre-Islamic customs are out the window. That has nothing to do with us anymore. We have to move on. However, people did not progress. People did not take this into consideration. Banu Bakr disregarded the treaty and disregarded the Prophet upon him and disregarded everything and went back to their ignorant and arrogant traditions, and they attacked Khuza'ah based off of this, based off their revenge and their pre-Islamic feuds with these people. Now, to make this even worse, even though they attacked and they went against the treaty and they killed many people in this attack, which is an attack at night, meaning the people were sleeping. You weren't even fighting them like men. You guys went and sneak attacked them in nighttime. To make it even worse, on top of all this, is that when the Khuza'ah, they understood what's going on, they're being attacked and they're seeing their family members being killed, innocent people being killed, some of them went to go seek refuge, they went to go seek protection around the Kaaba. Why? As we know in Islam, of course, the Kaaba is a haram, is a place where you cannot fight in it. And also this is even in the Quraysh and the Arab belief, in their traditions, that when someone is in the Kaaba, this is not a place for fighting. This is a place too holy and sacred for fighting and killing. So the Khuza'ah, naturally, they said, let's go to the Kaaba because they cannot do anything to us there. However, even in the Kaaba, Banu Bakr still attacked and killed them in front of the Kaaba, which is, of course, by all Islamically and through their tradition and their culture, is something that is beyond even thought of how wretched and wicked this is. As soon as this happened, of course, this is a people, Quraysh and Banu Bakr, together transgressed the boundaries of the treaty clearly, without a doubt. Now, Khuza'ah, of course, they rush. They immediately go to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who is, of course, in Medina. When they go to him and explain exactly what's happening, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam goes and he begins to write a letter to the Quraysh. And in this letter, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, demands either of two things. Either the Quraysh, they pay the blood money to the victims of the Khuza'ah and terminate their treaty with Banu Bakr, or the treaty of Hudaybiyah is now completely disregarded and is no longer in effect. So the Prophet Muhammad says you have to pay the blood money, something that we didn't discuss too much in detail. What the blood money is basically is an Islamic concept still present in today, is that if I kill someone, in order to act as an act of deterrence, there is something called the blood money, that if I kill someone, then the family can, you know, put on me or expect from me an amount that I have to pay in order, because I killed their son or I killed their daughter or I killed their family member. The concept of this is basically deterrence, so that it can discourage people from attacking and killing other people. Anyways, that's a whole different concept that we're not going to get into. One, you pay the blood money to the victims that you killed in, to the families of the people that you killed in Khuza'ah. And two, you cut off all ties with Banu Bakr. This is the condition and the demand of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is even an act of mercy from the Prophet upon him, because we clearly know that Quraysh, they did help them in some certain ways. However, since they were not fully responsible and fully, you know, the people who did the attack, they are given a chance to, you know, cut off Banu Bakr because they did the majority of the attack in order for them to be free. They have nothing to do with the Quraysh. And if they choose not to do this, the contract or the Treaty of Hudaybiyah has been breached. Now, the Quraysh, they know that they cannot accept this clause. In fact, they don't accept this this clause, this demand that the Prophet is upon him. Why can't they accept it? Because one, they cannot afford the blood money. The Quraysh already, as we discussed many times, are getting worse and worse in their economic situation. So now, if they play this blood money, and we said a lot of people were killed, they are not going to have enough money to bounce back and still remain some type of power inside the Arabian Peninsula. silsila, is that literally if they pay this blood money to the victims of Khuza'a, they are going to be broke. They're going to have no money in order to sustain themselves. So they cannot afford to pay the blood money. That's one. Second is that they cannot afford to cut off ties with Banu Bakr, because now everyone, virtually everyone in the entire Arabian Peninsula, was either Muslim or had treaties and contracts and dealings with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the only people left on polytheism and have some type of thought with Quraysh is Banu Bakr. So Quraysh cannot cut them off, because if they do, they are alone. They do not have any friends, do not have any allies, and they themselves are not powerful as they used to be anymore. So we clearly see that the Quraysh, they chose not to, because they literally can't. In their views, at least. Which means, of course, the Treaty of Hudaybiyah is breached, is cancelled, is no longer in effect. However, the Quraysh, they think that they are, you know, they're someone, or that they're going to, you know, manage to get away with this. So they send Abu Sufyan, who is the leader of Quraysh, the highest and biggest person in Quraysh now, to go talk to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in order to try to negotiate another treaty, another deal. And of course, this is something that, you know, even in its sense is mistaken. Like, how does someone send you in a demand and you choose to ignore it, choose to go against it, when you are clearly the transgressors, and try to make a new agreement? Obviously, just from our thought of head, obviously just from our thought, this is something that is ridiculous. Now, Abu Sufyan, he goes to Medina. Now, upon arriving at Medina, Abu Sufyan, he goes straight to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He goes to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he informs him what happens, and he tries to negotiate with the Prophet, peace be upon him, about the Treaty of Hudaybiyah and how, if they can restore it, and so on and so forth, so on and so forth. Now, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, subhanallah, the same way he did to the chiefs of Quraysh when he was in Mecca, and they tried to negotiate with him about his religion, and how he should give it up, and how he should sacrifice from it, the same way he did to Abu Sufyan when he came to him in Medina, he ignored them. He disregarded them. In fact, for Abu Sufyan, he didn't even speak to him. He completely disregarded him. The Prophet Muhammad ﷺ gave him a deal, and he chose to go against it. The Prophet Muhammad ﷺ is not going to compromise. The Prophet Muhammad ﷺ is not going to go against his word. He gave a deal. Even a deal, this deal that he gave before, is something that is merciful. It's something that he gave him a chance. Abu Sufyan and the Quraysh chose to not say accept it. That's it. End of story. Abu Sufyan, of course, panics. He wants this treaty to be in place. He panics, and he sees that the Prophet is not responding. So where does he go? He goes to Abu Bakr. He goes to Abu Bakr. He tries pleading and begging Abu Bakr to help him try to persuade the Prophet Muhammad to renegotiate the Treaty of Hudaybiyah, to establish a new deal. But Abu Bakr, he says, I cannot help you at all. Subhanallah. Then Abu Sufyan, he goes to Umar ibn Khattab. And Umar ibn Khattab, as we clearly see many times in the seerah, not only does he say, I'm not going to help you, in fact, he says, I refuse to help you in an aggressive manner. SubhanAllah, we see the two different responses of Abu Bakr and Umar. Now we have, after this, after Umar ibn Khattab aggressively says, I will refuse to help you, I will not help you at all, Abu Sufyan, he goes to Ali ibn Abi Talib. And Ali is who? The cousin of the Prophet. And we discussed many times that the Prophet is the cousin of who? Abu Sufyan. Which means that Abu Sufyan is related to Ali ibn Abi Talib. So he has some type of connection with him. So he goes to Ali ibn Abi Talib, and he begins having a very long conversation with Ali ibn Abi Talib. And he begins talking and begging Ali ibn Abi Talib to please persuade the Prophet upon him and do this and do that. And if you help me in persuading the Prophet upon him and achieving a new treaty, I will make Hassan, who is the son of Ali and the Prophet's daughter Fatima, I will make Hassan a leader amongst the Arab. However, Ali ibn Abi Talib, again, he refuses and he declines to help Abu Sufyan. And subhanAllah, we see the three different responses from these three different Sahabis. Each of them are correct. Each of them are according to the Sunnah, and they all did it in a correct manner. We just see the different forms, the different styles of how they rejected Abu Sufyan. You had Abu Bakr, who was soft. He said, I cannot help you. Like, he has no power to help him. Umar ibn Khattab, tough to the point. He said, I refuse to help you. Even if I could, I wouldn't. And then you had Ali ibn Abi Talib, who was the softest of the three, who allowed him to talk, allowed him to say what he had to say, and, you know, go for a long conversation, and then he refused to tell him. SubhanAllah. And we even see the quality of all the Sahaba, is that they would go in accordance of what the Prophet ﷺ did. How can they accept to help someone, or how can they offer help to someone that the Prophet ﷺ clearly refused to offer and deal with? So this is the responses of the Sahaba, and how it went exactly according to how the Prophet ﷺ dealt with him. Now, before Abu Sufyan, he goes, returns home embarrassed. SubhanAllah, look how the conditions completely switches. Now the Quraysh and Abu Sufyan are begging the Muslims for a treaty, and the Muslims are completely disregarding them. right? So before leaving Medina, and in fact, even some scholars say this even happened the first thing. However, it makes more sense that it happened the last thing. Before leaving Medina and going back to Mecca, Abu Sufyan goes and visits his daughter, Habiba. And Habiba is who? She is one of the wives of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And keep in mind that Habiba, she left and she hasn't seen her father for more than 13 years. Reason being is that she was one of the Muslims that went to Habasha. She was on the hijrah or the migration to Habasha, to Abyssinia. So she hasn't seen her father for more than 13 years. Can you imagine? Anyways, Abu Sufyan, he goes and he enters his daughter's house. And then he makes way to go and sit on her bed, which is also the bed of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. When he goes and he's about to go sit on the bed of the Prophet upon him, Habiba, she begins covering the bed and basically signaling and telling Abu Sufyan to not sit on the bed. That's when Abu Sufyan, he says, "My daughter, I do not know whether you think the bed is too good for me or that I am too good for the bed." SubhanAllah, this is clear what he's saying. Is that I don't know if that the bed, by you trying to not let me sit down, do you mean that the bed is too good for me? Or that I am too holy, or I'm too big, or too high for me to sit on this bed? This is when Habiba says, "This is the bed of the Prophet of Allah, and you are a filthy polytheist." SubhanAllah, look at how strong a response she gives to her own father, preferring the Islam and the Prophet upon him over her own father. Basically saying is that who are you to have the honor of sitting on the bed of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam while you plotted and went against us and killed us and plotted against us so many times? Who are you to do this? You idol worshiper, you know, so on and so forth. Which is very strong words, especially towards her own father. This is when Abu Sufyan, he leaves and he goes back to Mecca in complete embarrassment and humiliation. And he goes back to the Quraysh and he informs them what happened. And of course, the Quraysh is disappointed that they weren't able to establish another deal, another treaty with the Muslims. However, they were not fearing, or they did not think, that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam or the Muslims are going to go and attack them or seek revenge or go retaliate against them. However, they are of course very mistaken. This is when the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he commands all the Muslims to prepare for a battle without telling them the exact goal of what he is doing. So the Prophet ﷺ tells all the Muslims, and we're going to see how much Muslims actually take part of this, a huge number. He tells all the Muslims to prepare for battle. And he did not tell anyone, not Abu Bakr, not Umar, not Aisha, not anyone, the reason of this preparation. So everyone's preparing without knowing what they're preparing for. That's when the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, as a decoy, as a military plot, you can say, he sends 8 Sahabis to the north, northward. He sends a group of eight Sahabis northward. Why? So that it can seem that the Prophet Muhammad is preparing for, you know, da'wah, or preparing for a battle, play up away from Mecca, all the way up, somewhere elsewhere. However, of course, this would not be the case. The Prophet Muhammad was of course preparing for the conquest of Mecca, Fatih Mecca. However, before we talk about the number of the people who prepared and marched towards Mecca, a clear, very famous story happened in this moment. And this is the famous story of Hatib and the letter. It happens at this moment. Now this story, Wallahi al-Azim, is very complex and has many rulings derived from it and many scholarly commentary on it. Me and you are not scholars. We're not going to try to dive into the story. However, once again, we're just going to briefly skim over the story and what happened in it. And inshallah, if you guys have any time on your free time, or maybe even on this channel later on, we can discuss exactly what happened and the things that are being said about this incident. We can do that later on. However, for now, we're just going to mention the story. So the story of Hatib and the letter. So Hatib, he sends, who is a great Sahabi, by the way. He is a believing Muslim who is a great Sahabi. After some way knowing that the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ is now going or preparing for Fatih Mecca, he sends a letter with a messenger. He hires a messenger and he sends a message with her to go send to his family or some people in Mecca. So basically what he's doing is informing the people of Mecca, or some people in Mecca, that the Muslims are coming and prepare yourself. Now Hatib, he did not do this out of hate towards the Prophet, or trying to trick the Prophet upon him, or trying to go against the Prophet. Rather, he had personal family reasons why he did this, almost similar as what we discussed in the invasion of Banu Qurayza. Go back if you don't know what I'm talking about and who the person was that did that. Anyways, but it's similar to that. So he had no personal hate towards the Prophet, but he was overtaken by his emotion, and he had family there that he had personal reasons to inform them and warn them about and just say, you know, keep your head up, keep your eyes open, that this is going to happen in the next couple of days. However, make a long story short, the Prophet finds out about this and he sends Sahaba to go stop this messenger from giving this message. And they did. They capture this person, and then Hatib, he confesses, and then of course, you know, major thing happens. However, finally the Prophet Muhammad makes it clear to everyone that Hatib is forgiven, or he has been forgiven, he has been pardoned, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has favored those who participated in Badr. Anyways, long story short, this is what happens, and this is where the famous story occurs. So if you wanted to do research on your own, you can do that anyways. Here. Now back to the Fatih Mecca, the conquest of Mecca. After the Prophet sent this decoy of 8 men northward, he then prepared an army or a group of people to go march towards Mecca. This army was included the Prophet Muhammad and 10,000 of the Muslims to prepare for this historical event. 10,000 Muslims. SubhanAllah, when we were talking about the Battle of Badr not too long ago, how much were the Muslims? There was 300 in number, around 300. Now the Muslims are going to Fatih Mecca, to conquer Mecca, to the conquest of Mecca, to what? With 10,000 Muslims. SubhanAllah, what a great and humongous number. So the Prophet upon him and these 10,000 Sahaba, these 10,000 Muslims who marched towards Mecca, did so in the month of Ramadan in the 8th year of the Hijrah. Now, before arriving to Mecca and, you know, all the events that's going to happen there and we're going to discuss, we have major events that happened in between or in the journey between Medina and Mecca. Of them, which we will mention, is the acceptance of Islam by 3 major people from Quraysh. One of them being Abdullah ibn Umayyah, and another person being a man named Abu Sufyan. And no, not that Abu Sufyan. Even though we're going to speak about Abu Sufyan, who does accept Islam during this time, we're going to discuss him next. This Abu Sufyan is not that Abu Sufyan. This is Abu Sufyan bin Harith. The other Abu Sufyan is Abu Sufyan bin Harb. Anyways, so Abdullah ibn Umayyah and Abu Sufyan bin Harith, they go to Ibn Harith, they go and they to the Prophet Muhammad, and Abu Sufyan bin Harith, he recites beautiful words of poetry, beautiful verses to the Prophet Muhammad, and expresses his belief in the Prophet Muhammad, takes his shahada, and then both of them become Muslim. Now we have the story of Abu Sufyan bin Harb, yes, the famous Abu Sufyan that we all know and we've been talking about for many, many times and in many, many episodes. Abu Sufyan, he is also the cousin of the Prophet upon him, and also these 2 men that I mentioned before, Abdullah ibn Umayyah and Abu Sufyan bin Harith, they are also the cousins of the Prophet upon him. Anyways, Abu Sufyan, who is also the cousin of the Prophet, Abu Sufyan bin Harb, he wants to have another talk with the Prophet Muhammad. So he goes and he finds out that the Prophet is of course coming. You know, obviously he left Medina, he left Mecca, and he found out that the Prophet is coming. So he wants to meet with him. He wants to talk to him one more time. However, the Quraysh, the city of Mecca, do not know about anything that's going on. None of them know that the Muslims have, you know, approached or left Mecca, left Medina in a goal to go attack Mecca or a goal to conquer Mecca, better words. He goes to meet with the Prophet Muhammad. However, obviously he couldn't go there by himself. So with the assistance of the uncle of the Prophet Muhammad, who is Al-Abbas, who even some scholars say accepted Islam literally a couple of moments before this point. So with the assistance of Al-Abbas, Abu Sufyan manages to make it to the camp of the Muslims. Now when he is at the camp of the Muslims and he is approaching the tents of the Prophet Muhammad, the Muslims immediately recognize him. And they go and express that they want to kill Abu Sufyan. And keep in mind that they technically can, because there's no treaty, there's no anything going on, and Abu Sufyan is a clear enemy of the Muslims, so they can kill him. However, the Prophet Muhammad does not allow them to kill him. In fact, one person in specific who wants to kill Abu Sufyan, and subhanAllah, we hear this man's name many times in terms of someone who is always ready to defend and kill someone for the sake of the Prophet Muhammad, for the sake of Islam. And this is, of course, Umar ibn al-Khattab, who is always there, always ready to fight anyone who the Prophet Muhammad allows him to. However, once again, as in many situations, the Prophet does not allow Umar ibn al-Khattab to do this. Rather, the Prophet ﷺ tells Abu Sufyan and al-Abbas to come home, to come back tomorrow in order for them to discuss and talk about exactly what they need to talk about. When al-Abbas and Abu Sufyan go and sleep wherever they slept, they begin arguing and debating all night on accepting Islam. In fact, even the Prophet ﷺ, after he told Abu Sufyan to go home and then come back the next day, he even encouraged, or he even told Abu Sufyan, what is holding you back? Isn't it enough? Hasn't enough things come to you? Can't you finally accept Islam? So he's encouraging Abu Sufyan to start thinking about accepting Islam, which even is a mercy of the Prophet Muhammad. It's a generous act. He's giving him the opportunity to accept Islam and become a part of the Muslims. And if he becomes a part of the Muslims, like we said many times, there is nothing holding him back. There is nothing that's going to be any like wrong things labeled on him if he accepts Muslim. He will be forgiven and he will be free and he will be just like the other Sahaba. Anyways, Abu Sufyan, he goes to the Prophet Muhammad that next day, and he goes to the Prophet upon him and he begins praising and glorifying the Prophet upon him for his amazing manners, his amazing mercy, and his amazing generosity. And of course, Abu Sufyan, the biggest person and the biggest chief in Quraysh, he accepts Islam at this moment, and he begins asking the Prophet upon him to forgive him and pardon him for all the evil that he did towards the Prophet upon him and the Muslims, and to pardon him. And Abu Sufyan, from that moment, we have many narrations and stories talking about the bravery and the courage and the piety of Abu Sufyan. And even in fact, we have a hadith where the Prophet upon him, he himself says that Abu Sufyan is from the people of Jannah. Just to show you how great of a Muslim Abu Sufyan would later become. So Abu Sufyan is a part of the Muslims. Now, going back to Fath Mecca. The Prophet Muhammad ﷺ and the 10,000 Muslims march towards Mecca. As they are approaching, reminder, the Quraysh do not know what's going on. The Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, he begins dividing the army into ranks, into flanks, into whatever you want to call it, battalions, whatever. He begins dividing these Muslims, and then he gives every single one of these Muslims a clear and decisive decision, or a clear decisive order, a clear command. He says, do not kill a single person unless they attack you first, unless it's for self-defense. And this is, of course, clear, and going back to the point that we mentioned before, is that Mecca and the Kaaba in specific, the Haram, is a sacred land that fighting in it is not permitted. Even in fact, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you are not allowed to fight in it unless people fight you in it first. Which even is going to explain some of the things that's going to happen in the conquest of Mecca later on. However, in its essence, you are not allowed to fight there. And if we go back to Banu Bakr, they weren't attacked. They weren't acting out of self-defense. They were offensive and they killed the people. However, the Prophet subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them this clear instruction. Do not kill a single person unless they attack you first, unless it's out of self-defense. So the Prophet's problem, this even shows that he was not out to massacre Quraysh, even though they kicked him out of his land and they continued throughout his entire life trying to plot and kill him and do all these things. Any other leader, any other dictator, president, whatever you want to call it, would have acted completely contrary to the way the Prophet's problem acted in this situation. However, the Prophet's problem, being a mercy to mankind, being the greatest man ever to walk the earth, he of course takes the correct different approach than that of any other leader, that of any other empire and ruler in any other time, in any other place. Also, we see that the Prophet isn't going to sacrifice Islamic principle or Quranic principles by going to fight in the Kaaba, in the Haram. The only way that the Muslims might kill someone, which they are, as we're going to see, is out of self-defense. So the Muslims, they enter Mecca, and the Prophet Muhammad enters Mecca. Some of the Quraysh, they seen what's going on, they try to attack the Muslims, and the Muslims, without any effort, wallahi, without any effort, clearly and simply and very easily defeat them and kill them, for those who try to attack. The Prophet ﷺ then enters Mecca, and then before doing anything, he performs a salah called the salah to shukr, the praiseworthy, or the prayer of gratitude, showing his thanks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala of this great victory that's about to happen. So the Prophet ﷺ enters Mecca, and whoever tried to attack the Prophet ﷺ, the Sahaba of the Quraysh, they clearly defeated them, they clearly killed them. The Prophet ﷺ, first thing he did is praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this ni'mah, for this great blessing. He performs a salah, which we also learn is a salah, which is salat al-shukr. Next, the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ went to the Kaaba and he destroyed every single idol inside and around the Kaaba. He destroyed every single one of them while reciting verses in the Quran about the Kaaba and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deserves to be worshipped and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's victory is always with the Muslims and these type of verses. And then the Prophet ﷺ, he stands on the steps of the Kaaba and he delivers an amazing speech to a huge amount of people. The Prophet Muhammad ﷺ says, "There is no God but Allah alone without any partners. He has made good his promise that he has held to his servant and helped him defeat all the Confederates alone. O people of Quraysh, surely Allah has took from you all pride of the pre-Islamic era." He continued in this fashion and then he recited the verse in Surah Fussilat where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "O mankind, indeed we have created you from male and female and made you in peoples and tribes so that you may know each other. Inna akramakum indallahi atqakum," that verily the best of you or the most noble of you in the sight of Allah is that who is most pious or that who is most righteous. Indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is knowing and well acquainted. Then the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he asks an amazing question to the Quraysh. And this portion of the speech we all know and we all love and we all spread about Islam and about the Prophet peace upon him through this one phrase that the Prophet peace upon him is saying. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked the Quraysh, "What do you think I'm going to do with you?" And if you once again ask any other president, any other leader, any other dictator, any other ruler, empire, whatever you want to call it, what someone would do in this situation after finally being able, having power and control over people who abused him and tortured him and caused him pain and suffering for so many years, obviously what we would think is that he would kill them, he would punish them, he would put them in jail. That's when the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says the great words that we all know and we all love. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "I speak to you the same words as Yusuf spoke to his brothers. There is no blame on you today. لا تثريب عليكم اليوم." The great words that we all know and we all love, where the Prophet is upon him, what does he say? He says, "You guys are freed. There is no blame. There is nothing on you. There is no revenge on our part. We are going to let you go and you are free on this day." SubhanAllah, one of the greatest signs or the greatest evidences to show the Prophet is upon him's mercy towards the people, no matter who they are and what they did. SubhanAllah, what an amazing phrase about the Prophet peace upon him, quoting of course the Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam in that great story, which we will maybe discuss later on. Now, this is Fatih Mecca, and we clearly see the great wisdom and the great honor that was given to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi salam. And finally, after so many years of work and dedication and fighting and, you know, so many struggles and obstacles, finally the Muslims have dominated the entire Arabian Peninsula, and all the power is in the hands of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Wallahi, such an event. And we even see how easy it was for the Prophet to conquer Mecca. He literally just walked in and took over Mecca, and he told all the people in the Quraysh that you are free. What an easy victory. Of course, it was a meaningful victory. And so in order for him to have this victory, there was a lot of prerequisites, a lot of steps in before that he had to take. However, the victory itself was a very easy thing on the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Now, as for key events that happened after or immediately after the Fatih Mecca, the conquest of Mecca, we have one of the most beautiful sites in Islamic history, where you have Bilal ibn Rabah goes on top of the Kaaba and he calls adhan publicly and in front of all the people and on top of the Kaaba. This is the same Bilal ibn Rabah who, when he was owned by his owner, Umayyah ibn Khalaf, had a burning hot stone. We mentioned the story. Had a burning hot stone placed on his chest while Bilal ibn Rabah was laying there on the scorching hot sand. And where he was being tortured, while he was saying, "Ahadun, ahad, ahadun, ahad, one God, one God." And now, after so many years later, he would be on top of the Kaaba, the sacred and holy Kaaba, giving adhan and calling to the greatest pillar of Islam, which is the prayer. SubhanAllah, Bilal ibn Rabah went from having a rock of this dunya on top of him to giving adhan on top of a rock from Jannah. Because Hajar al-Aswad, as we discussed from the hadith, is that it is a rock from Jannah. And the Hajar al-Aswad is, of course, inside the Kaaba. And the Bilal ibn Rabah is giving adhan on top of the Kaaba, meaning he's on top of the rock from Jannah. Before, on top of him was a rock from this dunya, of this worldly life, and later on he was on top of a rock from Jannah. SubhanAllah, what an amazing story. The second major thing that happened in the conquest of Mecca is the Prophet upon him performs another salah, which is called Salat al-Fatih. So we learned from the Seerah, Alhamdulillah, we learned something called Salat al-Khawf, Salat al-Shukr, Salat al-Fatih, and many other forms of prayer, subhanAllah. The third major event that would happen is Safwan ibn Umayyah, a once enemy of Islam, accepts Islam. Another major event that would occur is that Ikrimah bin Abu Jahl and Hind, the wife of Abu Sufyan, and Wahshi, the person who killed Hamza ibn Abi Talib, Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib in the Battle of Uhud, they were all forgiven despite their clear acts and plots against the Muslims. And all of them, Wahshi, Hind, and Ikrimah bin Abu Jahl, would later in their lives accept Islam. Another major event that occurred is that the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ would give another speech on the next day after Fatih Mecca. And in this speech, he would discuss or he would make public the new rules and the new law in Mecca. Is that these things that you guys used to practice, that those are no longer in effect. And these Islamic principles are now in effect. So the Prophet ﷺ is now making it clear the rules in Mecca now. The new Islamic rules, only depending on Quran and Sunnah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Prophet, these are the new rules that are going to rule this land, and so on and so forth. Another event that happened that we can learn a lot from is when some of the Ansar came to the Prophet, peace upon him, expressing their fear. What were they fearing? The Ansari people, the people who were from Medina, they told the Prophet, peace upon him, that they feared that he would not return to Medina anymore. They feared that now that he conquered Mecca, he would not have any reason to go back to Medina. And then the Prophet says the famous saying of what? That I have lived with you and I will die with you. Meaning that he's not going to leave the people of Medina. He's not going to leave all that he did in Medina and all the history and all the ayat in the Quran and all the tradition in Medina and just, you know, go to Mecca and stay there from now. Rather, I'm going to live with you guys and I'm going to die with you guys inside Medina. And this is clearly the case, as we all know. The Prophet, of course, he dies in Medina, as we're going to discuss at the end of the seerah. So the Prophet, he goes, and of course, after a certain amount of time, he returns to Medina, and he does live there, and he does eventually die there. A next major event that would happen is the Quraysh. What happened to them? They realized that the only hope for them, that the only realistic life for them in Mecca was if they accepted Islam. So majority of them, they accepted Islam. However, as for those who didn't accept Islam, you find many stories of them leaving. We even have, you know, another explanation of a verse in the Quran. For example, the verse about kill them wherever you find them, which has in a significant role in Fatih Mecca and what the Prophet said and the deal he gave them. But the Quraysh, majority of them accepted Islam. As for those who didn't accept Islam, they really had no point being in Mecca. Anyways, another point that happened, and I even discussed this in one of my videos. You can check it out if you want. It's called "Am I a Terrorist?" Where I discussed that portion of the story, which is how can we explain the verse, kill them wherever you find them. Anyways, another thing that happened is that the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ would only stay in Mecca at that point. Of course, he would return later on to Mecca. He would only stay at that point in Mecca for 19 days, teaching the people the Islamic principles and making clear the Islamic laws inside Mecca. And then he would go back to Medina. Also, he commanded all the Sahaba that if they see any idol in the people's houses or outside in the streets or in the Kaaba or wherever it is, that it be destroyed and broken. And finally, we see after such a great event, and such a great story. We're not even finished the seerah, even though we're pretty close. We see clearly the change and clearly the shift of size, the shift of power. Where the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ went from having a handful of Muslims, them hiding in secret, spreading Islam and teaching Islam and being persecuted and even some of them being executed and killed and tortured and all these things that would happen, them being kicked out of Mecca, them being on, you know, Uhud and Badr and Khandaq and Khaybar and all these things that would happen, all that we discussed, subhanAllah, now we see that the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ has religious superiority, has religious supremacy, and he has worldly power. Now the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ literally has all the power inside the Arabian Peninsula, and we're going to see later on, and even in the lives of the Sahaba after the death of the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, where they would spread this power to other continents and other cities and other countries as well. However, we see that the Prophet Muhammad is literally the most powerful man in all aspects, in terms of economy, in terms of religion, in terms of politics, in terms of social life, literally in everything. The Prophet Muhammad is now number one inside the Arabian Peninsula, and of course in religion in the world. However, in Arabia, he is number one. And we see this after a very long process and a very great story. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Thank you guys for watching. As you clearly see, we are approaching the end of the seerah. So please stay tuned and please, you know, watch these episodes as we are really getting close to the end. We clearly see a major event that happened in the seerah, something that we can learn so much from. Even in fact, as I mentioned in the beginning of the episode, this is not even everything that happened in the Fath Mecca. You can literally find many stories and many narrations and many ahadith that occurred and happened in here. And you can even, you know, learn and benefit from, you know, a specific situation that I didn't mention. However, we clearly see how the Prophet and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's aid and help came to the Prophet Muhammad, and now the everything is changing now. Everything is coming into play now, where the Muslims are finally victorious, and after so many years of hard work and dedication and obstacles and struggles, they are now victorious and have the aid of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fully, and in, you know, it shows the results in front of them. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. See you guys next week.